Good evening, and welcome to Chicago Public Library. I'm Jennifer Lezak with the Cultural, Civic, and Literary Engagement Division at CPL, and on behalf of everyone at Chicago Public Library, welcome. We want to especially welcome you to Chicago Public Library throughout 2023 as we celebrate our 150th anniversary year with a variety of events, celebrations, partnerships, and digital content for all ages throughout the year. For more information about everything we have going on, visit shipublib.org/150 throughout the year. Tonight's event, highlighting an important part of Chicago's musical history that you may not have known about, is presented as part of CPL's 150th anniversary celebrations and is also part of Summer at CPL programming for adults. Before we begin, we ask that you please silence your cell phones. I would like to thank the Chicago Public Library staff who worked to make this event possible. Books are available for purchase in the lobby, courtesy of our partners Sandmeyer's, and the author will sign books after our discussion out in the auditorium lobby. Tonight's event is also being live streamed on CPL's YouTube and Facebook channels, and it will be available for on-demand viewing immediately following the event, so tell a friend who missed it. Tonight's Chicago Public Library is so pleased to welcome Mark Guarino in conversation on his new book, Country and Midwestern, Chicago in the History of Country Music and the Folk Revival. Mark covers national news and culture from Chicago for the Washington Post, ABC News, the New York Times, and many other outlets. He was the Midwest Bureau Chief for the Christian Science Monitor for 7 years. In Country and Midwestern, Mark tells the epic century-long story of Chicago's influence on sounds typically associated with regions further south. Drawing on hundreds of interviews and deep archival research, he tells a forgotten story of music, migration, and the ways in which rural culture infiltrated urban communities through the radio, the automobile, and the railroad. Joining Mark for the conversation is Monica Eng. Monica will also be appearing here this summer as part of Summer at CPL for her book, Made in Chicago, which is all about Chicago food. That is on August 9th, so please come back for that. They're also going to be joined by Greg Cahill and Marc Edelstein, co-founders of the Landmark Group Special Consensus, along with Special C alums mandolin master Don Stiernberg and guitarist Chris Walz. Thank you so much to Monica for moderating. And after the conversation, please stick around for a special musical performance. And now, please join me in welcoming Mark Guarino and Monica Egg to the CPL stage.
Thanks so much for the kind introduction, and thanks everybody for coming out on this gorgeous night. I know I am super excited to talk to Mark about this book and to hear from the actual musicians who are mentioned in the book. You know, Mark, I picked up this book thinking, oh, I know all about this stuff, but you opened up this entirely new world to me, even though I spent a ton of time in Uptown during the 70s, 80s, and 90s when my dad was a choir director at a church there, so we were there 5 days a week, and I never knew any of this. I saw bits and pieces, but you know, this history, I think, opens up so much more information about our own city to me and others. What inspired you to write it?
I think that I covered music for quite a long time, and I spent many, many years interviewing musicians and covering a lot of the standard stories that were out there. Over that time, I just started hearing stories about Chicago's inherent connection to country music. And I knew Uptown well. I went to Loyola, so I rode my bike through the neighborhood a lot. I got to really see it in the late 80s and early 90s. And over time, I realized that the country music that I was being exposed to in the 90s, which was being called alternative country at the time, because they were people who weren't necessarily raised by country music, but connected to the themes of it. Were playing music, original music, that those musicians and the people that enabled those musicians, record label owners and people who opened clubs, they were connected to the scene that happened behind them. And so it was sort of, for me, it was kind of a detective story in a way, kind of opening it up and seeing that this history goes back 100 years to the 1920s, but no one, it really hadn't been told, and it had actually been downplayed, in fact, for many years.
And I think the same thing happened to me that you kind of mentioned happened to you. As you're writing chapters and bits and pieces, by the end of it, you're like, wait a minute, there are connections here. There are, you know, themes that are gelling over the whole arc of this. What were some of the things that kind of occurred to you after putting it all together?
I spent over 10 years on the book, and when you spend something that you live with it, so it really becomes a part of you, and you're surrounded by it at home. And one thing that really emerged from it was that Chicago, because of its distance from the coast, it had this real spirit of experimentation and collaboration among musicians of many different genres. So genre was never really a big deal in Chicago because you had musicians, they all lived together in the same city. And there wasn't really a big commercial industry here. So there was not that pressure to remain strictly formulaic to have a hit. And so what really happened was over many time periods, you had people making music here and following their own path and finding their own voice, but it kind of worked out for them in many ways. It influenced people beyond them, and the story kept repeating over and over. The second big theme was the spirit of generational handoff. So you had people, you had different generations who, you know, you always hear about a clash between older people and younger people. In Chicago, I kept encountering these stories of older people wanting to give back and really wanting to, like, show younger people what they knew. And that story kept repeating throughout the book. It's a really beautiful story. And I think it's a story of musicians who I think that are inherently very open and... And so that's something that kept going from, you know, the 20s and 30s all the way up through the 90s.
I loved reading the chapter where it was sort of like we had these three big scenes, the Madison street scene, the uptown scene, and Highwood. I had no idea Highwood, but I guess with the naval base there.
There's a naval base there, so there were sailors who wanted to go out and hear music and have a fun time, and there were country bands up there, and it was a pretty raucous scene. And so, yeah, no, at the time in the 50s, you know, really in the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, all the way up, there were these really, in some way you can call them vice districts. And then they were more or less storefront honky-tonks where bands played, and, you know, seven nights a week. And there's a, you know, the book talks about the second migration from the South, which were white Southerners who came up searching for work. And they brought with them their culture, their music, and they tended to band together. And you could go to certain areas of uptown, and it would just be like the South. People had a twang, people played the music. You didn't have to go down to Alabama to hear the music. It was happening right there on Wilson Avenue.
I think you had a statistic in there that 80% of uptown's population in 1960 was born in the South. That is just... astounding to me. One more thing. Who's seen Blues Brothers? Okay, who saw that scene where there was chicken wire and they sang Rawhide? Is there any basis in truth to that? And where is that supposed to be?
Well, I mean, I don't know where that's supposed to be, but I think that's sort of this thing, this idea that, you know, the music came from the bars and the bars. You know, in the people talk about Chicago violence today, but... it's totally tame compared to this. That's nothing what's going on today because, you know, in early on, those districts we were talking about, these were really where the bands play. They were violent places. And so I had to go look at the police blotter from the Chicago Tribune from like the 40s and 30s, the 50s, and they were filled with incredible stories. They were written like pulp novels, more or less, and bands played there. And one musician I interviewed, who's no longer with us, told me a story once of his band's playing, and also in a fight brings out of a rival club owner comes in, and they were rivals across the street. And so there's a gunfight that breaks up, and a gun goes through his guitar neck. Yeah, and he keeps playing, they're playing, and you know, decades later, gosh, I don't even want to do the math. That memory was stuck in his brain. He was living it when he told me, and I thought, he's probably prone to exaggeration. And so I researched it, and I found that, no, that actually happened. I found the police report and the story that of that. And so it really kind of brought that to life, the type of places they were, and I think the Blues Brothers scene sort of like capitalized on that.
And through that crucible of poverty and violence and destitution, some really incredible music came out of that, and you do such a great job of painting that picture. You also get into politics, and it seems like you've really carefully researched that. I mean, reading about the young patriots joining together with the young lords, the Puerto Rican gang, and the Black Panthers. I mean, wow.
Yeah, I mean, it was a time of urban renewal, which was what it was called back then, gentrification, we call it today, and the first Mayor Daley, and not just the city administration, but also the powers that be of the city. They looked at these neighborhoods not for the really interesting things that were happening there, but they were problems. They wanted to develop the city to make it more of a world-class city, which meant that the poor people there had to be moved out. And so this was like a 30-year plan, But what was the amazing thing about that story is that the young people who were actually in street gangs, they changed and they became resistant to what the city was doing, and actually they became activist organizations. That's the remarkable thing. These were kind of like street kids. And so you had a white street gang, you had the Black Panthers that we all know about, and you had the Young Lords, which was the Puerto Rican street gangs, three marginalized groups. And the young patriots, their symbol was the Confederate flag. They had it on their denim jacket, but they worked alongside the Black Panthers, and then the other amazing thing is that collaboratively there was music happening between these groups as well, and the Old Town School of Folk Music was so important because they had a satellite. I don't want to call it venue, but they had a satellite location in Uptown because they saw themselves as serving the Southerners who'd moved up. They would give away guitars. They would encourage music playing on Saturday nights. And so, and then folk music stars from that period would pen protest songs with them. And so it was this incredible mixture of groups that I don't think would be happening today.
So, yeah, I mean, so and the themes of those times were lots of different groups joining together against Chicago police brutality and gentrification. How things have changed in Chicago.
Right, that's right. That's right.
But so you can read about all those themes in the book. But without further ado, the most important theme in the book is music. So who would we like to?
Well, you know, so the book is dedicated to musicians. I have talked to musicians pretty much my entire life, and especially the last 10 years for this book, and an era that I kind of really was fascinated with was the 70s, when bluegrass was being rediscovered by a whole new generation of essentially 20-year-olds and 20-year-olds in Chicago who had never really heard, you know, didn't grow up with the music at all. And so the music was being rediscovered then, and a band that formed called Special Consensus in 1975, they essentially were the band that really decided to take the music as a, they became a touring unit, but not from Tennessee, but from Chicago. So they were really a pioneering band in breaking down all of those barriers. And they're still going today. And the leader we can call to the stage is Greg Cahill.
Come on down.
And Mark Edelstein, woo! Co-founders of Special Consensus. And with them are some Special Consensus alumni, Chris Walz and Don Stiernberg.
And Roger. Roger's there, I'm sorry. Wow.
Thanks for doing this. I all these events, I really wanted them to focus to be on the musicians because I really wanted to, first of all, it means I don't have to talk as much, but also because I think that it's really important to hear their stories and to hear the music as well in a setting like this because it's just kind of a different one, I think, for you. You tour all the time.
It is, and it's a real privilege for us to be here. Thank you for inviting us, and thanks for the wonderful book because we learned, I think in every chapter, in every segment of every chapter, there was something we learned and we were there. But it was like, oh, I didn't know that guy wrote that song, or I didn't know, you know, that those people had came from wherever. And it's just it's a wonderful masterpiece. It really is. Thank you for that.
So, I just know you guys from the book. It's so amazing to see you in the flesh. But I think, you know, Mark, you were saying that people initially didn't really want to accept a bluegrass band from Chicago. When they heard Chicago, they were like, what? Can you tell us about that and kind of how you won them over?
Well, it was a pretty tight group of folks who really, the genre, people, you know, were very astute at learning the songs and learning everything that their heroes would do or play or write. And I think, and we were just to be able to play and have people come and hear us who didn't know what bluegrass was. So we would put in some old rock and roll songs or blues numbers or whatever. And so then, that wasn't always well accepted in the more traditional world, you know. And plus, just the mental concept of people coming from Chicago who'd never lived in the South or been experiencing, you know, firsthand the music. It was just like, well, you just can't do it, right?
I mean, I know that people confronted me several times, asking me why I was playing this music. And my argument was always that the music hit me very strongly. I felt that it was very powerful, and I felt that it was important to me to learn how to play it. And some people were a little more accepting then, but not everybody.
Conversely, when we would tour in the South, when I was in the band in the late 90s, I'm originally from upstate New York. And that's where I first came in contact with bluegrass music through a radio show called The Bluegrass Ramble, hosted by a guy named Bill Knowlton. And Greg would always introduce me as being from upstate New York. And we would play, you know, gigs or festivals down south. And usually at the record table afterwards, some folks would come up, and they'd usually be, you know, an older generation, and they would single me out, and they'd look at me, and they'd say, where'd a boy from New York learn to pick that bluegrass? Didn't know they had it up y'all's way, you know, kind of thing. And I would say how I got into it and all that. And so a connection, you know, could sort of be made, but in the beginning there was a little bit of incredulity. It's like, you know, how did you get from here to there?
But you guys mentored with some greats that you found in Chicago, and you sought many of them out. Can you talk about that a bit?
One of the first name that comes to mind from that era in the 70s was Leon Jackson, who had written some songs, especially a very popular one in the bluegrass repertoire, and it was called Love Come Home, and Bill Monroe recorded it. And we found Leon just living in Uptown, and hanging out with some other folks from Kentucky or maybe Tennessee, and he was still writing songs but living in, you know, kind of in poverty. It was a shame.
How did you know to go to Uptown? I mean, and also seek him out. What was that like? Because how old were you when you went down? When you started?
I was maybe around 30, actually.
Okay. So how did you know, like, to go there and where to go? And did you go to any of the bars there?
They used to have a Sunday afternoon jam session. Well, they had one down by University of Chicago at Jimmy's Woodlawn Tap.
That's right.
Yeah. And then people would go there, and then sometimes some of the folks from Uptown would go there and say, hey, we Sunday afternoon, we also do this up here. And so and they were very open. You know, it was really great. It was actually a nice tight-knit community of all the pickers, and that was their big thing on Sunday, to be able to play.
What was the club in Uptown? Where'd you go there?
Say that again?
Where did you go in Uptown for the Sunday?
Well, I can't. I think it was the pub.
Was it
we
the Lakeview? Oh, the Lakeview Lounge. Does anybody remember the Lakeview Lounge with the band in the back of the bar? I think it was Night Train the last time I went there. Night Watch.
There ain't no lake and there ain't no view.
And was that common to have the band behind the bar, or was that sort of a novelty there? I mean, no band, Chicken wire.
It's kind of a novelty.
Yeah.
Just like that bar.
Yeah. Yeah. Most of us were in front of the window. Which had its issues too at some of the places because.
And when you met Leon, you know, you got to know him, right? I mean, and you went back and hung out with him, and how did he? What was that interaction like?
He was just very happy that younger people were interested, and he wasn't that old, but he had had cancer, so he couldn't understand. He had jaw cancer, so. Had a hard time, so he could hum the melody of the song that he wrote and give you the words, and just that he trusted us with the music, right?
Well, you know, the fact was that we recorded his material. Even I think one of the tunes had never been recorded before.
Two of them, I think. Yeah.
Right, so he trusted us with his material, and we certainly tried to pay respects to his artistry.
What were those two tunes that you recorded?
One was called Late Last Night, and what was the other one?
Get out your record.
I know. I brought the record. It's in the green room. Mm-hmm. Well, and then what? Can you talk a little bit about the? I mean, I think the other person that we wanted to talk about was Jethro Burns, and that's a story that I repeat a lot at these events because I was telling Don that. It's really a beautiful story, but it's also kind of a story. It tells a bigger story of the book of this kind of generational handoff, and Jethro Burns, as many of you probably already know, was in the duo Homer and Jethro, and huge. They were major recording stars. I mean, they played for U.S. presidents. They toured. You couldn't get really much any bigger in the recording field than them. And later in their life, Jethro Burns retired and he lived in Evanston, and he opened up his basement to teach because he really was looking for something to do. I think that Don, you told me he had gone kind of depressed in his life, and I think his wife was kind of pushing him to get out there and teach. And you were one of his students. You were living nearby.
Yeah, the biggest blessing in my life was when my mother heard an ad on WFMT radio, or the Midnight Special program.
Who remembers Midnight Special? It's still going though, right? Yeah.
Yeah, it sure is. In fact, this Saturday night there's a tribute to Steve Goodman, a 3-hour Steve Goodman tribute program. Hello.
Listen up this week.
But yeah, I had started to fool around with the mandolin, trying to be like my older brother who played banjo and guitar. This is the folk boom of the 1960s going on. And I started to teach myself by learning Woody's Rag by Woody Guthrie, played by Pete Seeger on a mandolin on a live Weavers album. Right, and so I was, you know, just kind of struggling with the mandolin, and then, as I mentioned, my mom heard this ad on the Midnight Special, study mandolin with the great Jethro Burns. And mom says, oh, you seem to like that mandolin. You think maybe you should take some lessons with this Jethro Burns. I said, what's a Jethro Burns? You know, I had no idea. I was... greatest blessing in my life. I went for lessons with him, and I found my direction in life on that first lesson that I got with him. From that moment on, I wanted to be him. You know, I wanted to play the mandolin, be a working musician, and try to be cool as hell like he was. But, you asked me something else. I'm sorry.
It's interesting because I think after you told me that story and I started doing more interviews, and it seemed like all of these, like, essentially kids on the North Shore who wanted to learn music, they started basically finding themselves to that basement in Evanston. Right. I think the word got out, right? And he was, as a teacher, he had something, you were talking about his eye contact. He would make you record the lessons, right? And now I think there's a website out there that you can go find all those lessons people have uploaded.
Where I come from, you know, he was the first grown man that looked me in the eye, let's put it that way. And I realized what a great teaching technique it was, because it kind of creates an adrenaline flow that then enables one to hear the stuff and commit it to memory very quickly, because none of it was written down. You know, we weren't writing music of all these things, or it was all, you know, verbal exchanges and notes played. And what tied it all together was that gaze, you know. I could tell he was serious about all of it.
And then he ended up performing then, I think, with then Steve Goodman, but also with you, and he played on bills with all of you, right? I mean, yeah. he the last 10 years of his life, and he had a whole other chapter of his life in which he was performing on Chicago stages everywhere with young bands. And, Greg, do you remember that at all? Did he play with Special Consensus at all?
Oh, yeah. We actually had tried, well... And this relates to what you were saying about the great community, because we had tried to play at the Earl of Old Town for a long time, which was the premier, you know, folk club and then music club, right, in Chicago on Wells Street. And we finally got to play there. That's how we met Steve Goodman the very first night, because he was sitting right in the front row. And he would come out to hear bands, you know. And then eventually we played one weekend a month. We opened for Jethro there, and it was great because it was also across the street from Second City, so we would time it, and you could sneak across and then go catch the improvs that came after midnight, you know. Yeah. But and he was really so kind to me, because I recorded and it wasn't my idea, a friend, I made my first solo recording in 1980 and asked, I got the nerves, I don't know how, to ask him if he would play on it, and he did. Sure, I will. You know, and he was just a great guy. You know.
Tell him about Freight Train Boogie.
Yeah, right. Freight Train Boogie.
No, tell
him. What about it?
What I heard was Special Consensus made one of their many great albums, and it was called Freight Train Boogie, and it featured the song Freight Train Boogie, which goes back in the history of country music all the way to the Delmore Brothers. One of their greatest songs. And didn't you ask Jethro to write the notes?
I did.
And you told him that what, you know, the title of the song was, and he said, yeah, sure, I played on that record.
Yeah, I know those guys really well.
like Mark was saying earlier, it seems kind of like one big band after a while. There's so many connections.
Nice. Yeah.
I was going to point out also earlier, pardon me, but you were saying when Jethro got depressed, that was when his partner of, I think, 39 or 40 years, Homer Haynes, passed away suddenly, age of 52, I think. And that was what threw Jethro for a loop, and he started sitting around, and it was his wife, Gussie, that told him, you got to do something. And that's when she sent him down the street to teach mandolin. Yeah. Yeah. And that's also when he started, shortly after that, he was when he hooked up with Goodman to perform, and all these other connections that were just mentioned.
Yeah. Well, I'd love to know from the musician's point of view, sorry to keep going back to the Blues Brothers, how accurate was that Blues Brothers country music bar scene? Was it that raucous in some of those honky-tonks in Chicago back then?
Well, that's hard to... I mean, it was. There were some that could be considered a little rugged. The scene that we played was the Lincoln Avenue scene, and it was so great, as you mentioned in the book. You know, you could just one at Orphans and
Holsteins
and somebody else's troubles, and then across the street, Lilies for the Blues and Irish Eyes.
And the Clearwater Saloon was a bar dedicated just to bluegrass music,
more or less.
Amazing, a bluegrass music bar, club. Yeah.
And that got,
that could be rough.
That could be.
Was there any chicken wire in front of the stage?
Well,
if I can relate a story, we were playing
one night. Let's bring the mic up a little closer.
The window.
The stage was at the very front of the bar in a big picture window, and we were playing, and shots were fired right outside the window, and everybody in the bar ducked except for me. I hid behind my bass and took a look, and somebody grabbed me and pulled me down. But that was, I mean, we would see things like that every once in a while. One time I was walking to the Clearwater Saloon across Lincoln Avenue, and two rival gangs were approaching each other on Lincoln Avenue.
Wow.
And I quickly ran and got out of the way, and a fight broke out there. And I saw a beating out the window. It had its moments.
Well, there's a photo in my book, right, almost when it was very, at the very end when I was going to turn it in. All the photos were done, but then I encountered a photo of outside the Clearwater Saloon with all these motorcycles parked in front, and all these guys in leather crouched down, sitting on the sidewalk. And I thought, I'm going to get that photo and put it in the book too. I can't let that one's got to go in there as well. And I think that kind of speaks to what you're talking about. Yeah.
It wasn't always like that.
Yeah.
There were moments.
Yeah.
Now, I think we've all been reading this book over the last few weeks and, you know, underlining passages and learning so much stuff about a scene that we thought we knew. I don't want to put you on the spot, but what were some of the most interesting and surprising things that you learned from this book? I'll start. That Gene Autry and a whole bunch of other country music stars lived on Malden in like 1939, I told my mother that, who lived right around the corner on Racine. And she said, I was in love with Gene Autry. I can't believe he, you know, she was born in 44. But the idea that there were so many of these country music stars right here.
Yeah, that's because of the WLS Barn Dance, for sure, that started in 1924. And actually, we're coming to the 100th anniversary of it next year. They all lived, those musicians came here, they lived on the north side, some of them lived even further up, and that was the kind of stable of people who, over the at least the first two decades of it, are pretty incredible, and were pioneers in country music. I mean, Carl Davis, who was a mandolin player on the WLS Barn Dance, and Doc Hopkins, those were early, we can call them bluegrass pioneers. Bill Monroe looked up to them and is on record talking about how much he admired Carl Davis's playing and who was part of a duo called Carl and Hardy. So these were people who were stars of their day, but some of them didn't transition over. But they were, when you're talking about the early pioneers of country music, especially country radio, they were here in Chicago.
So
by the 60s, I think, the Barn Dance had become a television program. Mm-hmm. And I grew up watching that and loving it, and all the various characters on that version of the Barn Dance, many of whom are covered really, really well in the book. And the one I'm thinking of right now especially is Bob Atcher, who we knew off the TV show as the mayor of Schaumburg.
Really?
Yeah, because he was.
Oh. He founded Schaumburg.
And
yeah.
Schaumburg was very rural, I think, at the time,
yeah.
too.
Until he got hold of it.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
But what I didn't know about this guy that I used to watch on TV every week was that he, in the earlier, you know, version, the radio version of the Barn Dance, he was recruited to be the host because he was a million-selling country star. I had no idea.
Wow.
He was a Columbia Records recording star. Yeah,
and mayor of Schaumburg at the same time.
And then, well, no. And then later, I think when things, he didn't want to move. So that's things, he wanted to stay put, and he moved out. And I think he fell in love with the land there, and he founded the village of Schaumburg,
wow.
the city of Schaumburg. And he, Gene Autry really started the image of the singing cowboy. That was sort of like a really kind of, it was an image that worked really well in films and in recordings. And Bob Atcher was a later incarnation. They had several singing cowboys, and Bob Atcher was the one that that when you guys came around, then there he was, you know, on TV.
Right.
Yeah.
Never
missed that show. It would come around every week.
Yeah. Any other tidbits you guys learned that you were surprised at?
Well, that was one for me. I knew he had become the mayor. I didn't realize he founded the whole entire city. And I think a really cool thing is a lot of the people that you mentioned, we got to know some of these people from the barn dance. You know, Johnny Frigo, right, and Bob Atcher, and several of the folks who had appeared on that show were still here and almost mentoring everybody, you know. And I'd say Jethro was kind of the godfather of all of it, though. And if you think about it, everybody, you know, just respected him and admired him, and he was good to everybody. You know?
He was another one, like Bob Atcher, who was a superstar. And,
yeah.
And I think that explains the whole... I mean, Homer and Jethro as an act were... They were a superstar in each medium that came along in the 20th century, starting on the radio, going to television, like mm-hmm. so, you know, Vegas, million selling records, the whole thing. And yeah, those guys got a lot of attention, well deserved. Yeah.
Any other cool tidbits you learned? Okay, sorry, I don't want to be like, did you do your homework?
I did not do my homework. The dog ate my book.
Yeah.
He didn't have to study history. He was there.
The point that Mark was making earlier about the older generation, you know, wanting to further the music by teaching the younger generation, you know, you mentioned Doc Hopkins, and, you know, later on he had an early morning, you know, radio show, kind of a wake-up show, and... Two banjo players at different times, you know, went to him, and he mentored them. One was Fleming Brown, who wound up being either like the first or second banjo teacher that was hired at the Old Town School. And the other was Stephen Wade.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that Fleming Brown wanted, you know, in the book I talk about Pete Seeger's playing in town, and Fleming Brown goes to him and says, "Can you teach me?" And he says, "No, but this guy in your city is better than me. Go learn from him." And it was Doc Hopkins, who was, yeah, a WLS barn dance star who just stayed put in Chicago. And I think that continuum from Doc Hopkins to Fleming Brown to Stephen Wade to all of you on the stage is a direct line, which is goes all the way back to the 20s. Yeah. There's... one thing about Special Consensus I was going to ask you, Greg, is that you made it a touring band, and you weren't just going to play the Lincoln Avenue scene. You were going to go out into the world and kind of breaking down, go to these festivals that there had never been a Chicago band at, and you really were, in a way, I kind of see you as kind of breaking down barriers of kind of getting out there, getting the band out there, recording, and all that. I mean, what was your vision for the band when you formed it, and were you aware of sort of some of those challenges that you had to have in the early years?
Well, we were definitely aware of the challenges because it was really difficult to get booked even, you know, and we'd drive so many all-night drives and sitting by the side of the road when the car breaks down. And I mean, it was not easy. But I think when the two of us decided to, you know, the band was around in 73, 74, actually, with some guys that we had met at the University of Chicago Folk Festival. And we would just hang out in between acts and go play bluegrass music in the halls, you know. But that when we decided we wanted to try this, I think the vision was, let's do this for a couple years. Let's just really do it, see what it's all about. And we were still learning the music, too, and that was going to give us the opportunity to really hear how they played the music in different parts of the country. So it was going to be maybe we'll do this a couple years, get it out of our system, you know, and then
it
didn't work at all. It just got worse. It was like, oh, no, now we got to... You know, I want to see. Let's go to Texas. What's that like? You know, and what's this music like? It wasn't all about going to Kentucky or Tennessee. I mean, it was national. You know, California has a phenomenal bluegrass scene, and look at all the great bluegrass musicians that came from New York. You know, so
right.
It was a learning experience. It was vibrant. It was great.
And the band became something different because in that, like so many, every 5 years you have a reunion show of all the people who have played in Special Consensus, and that list is very, very long, and also very impressive. All the and you, both of you and so many really impressive, great master musicians have cycled through Special Consensus as well. And was that did that kind of something that kind of became a part of it? That like were you aware of this sort of in a way you were kind of doing it evolved in sort of this mentorship thing. You kind of adopted that role as years went on, especially today.
Well, I think, you know, when we were the young guys and it was so hard, it was like, I think the two factors when we look for new people were, number one, we never try to exactly replace the person who was leaving, you know, because then people are going to make comparisons. Oh, the other person was better, you know. And so we would, you know, if somebody was a great guitar player, we might and try to make sure we hired a really great singer who played guitar, you know, or and part of the equation was young people. We try to get young people because then they would have an opportunity.
And the energy.
Make them drive all night. Yeah. No. And I think that just sort of became a thing there. And we always tried to get people. You live with each other for days, weeks on the road. So that was another factor. It's not always about being the best player or singer. You have to be, you know, kind of a good person is where we were coming from, because we were going to be a family, you know. And then word would spread. It got a little easier as we were around longer, and people just, I mean, then we were able to get gigs and pay some people the money. And it was interesting because up until probably the 90s, people would move here to be in the band. But then by, I guess, the late 80s, early 90s is when then a lot of the bands started having people live in different cities or different states even. And that happens all the time now. But, of course, now people can fly. Back then you couldn't afford to fly. So that's why people would live in the town you were in, because you drove everywhere. And that took a lot of hours to, you know, to drive to Texas and play the next day, you know, was yeah.
Well, and I love the fact that you became the president of the International Bluegrass Association in Nashville, which is an amazing story from a band from Chicago that shouldn't have been playing bluegrass, and then you became the president of the industry's organization and a multi-Grammy nominee, too. So that's really an amazing journey for you and the music.
Before we go to the musical portion of this, is there anything else you want people to know about this era, about Chicago as a country music center?
Well, I think just one thing for me was that Chicago was, the musicians were very open, and at any given time, at any given show, there was probably two or three musicians that would be coming to hear us, but they were blues musicians or rock musicians, and vice versa, we'd go here. So it was really cool. It was a really good community that everybody was supporting everybody.
I'll pick up on that. University of Chicago Folk Festival.
Yeah. All right, remember February.
I was going to pick up on what Greg was saying, and earlier on we were talking about the reception of bluegrass music being played by guys from Chicago everywhere else in the country. And I learned right at those moments listening to these guys talk about maybe we felt like it wasn't appreciated in other parts of the country, because what we were accustomed to in Chicago was everybody's accepting of everything, you know. The musicianal, the community of musicians, that's how they worked. You know, there wasn't anything like, hey, you don't do that right.
So the barriers were broken down and people could experiment across genres.
I think that might have contributed to some of our feeling about people who would, you know, introduce a Special Consensus and say, Now, folks, they're from Chicago, but give them a hand anyway.
Right, you know, right.
And then they bring the Special Consensus band out on stage at a bluegrass festival anywhere, And when it was observed that the band was from Chicago, you could hear the lawn chair snapping and people just taking off. You
know. Right. Time to go take a bathroom break. I don't want to hear this.
Oh, Greg used to do it to me something awful when, you know, he would, and I know he would do it as a joke. And if we played to somewhere north or to a younger crowd, they would sort of chuckle at it. But Greg would always introduce me and, oh, here's our guitar player, and he's from the bluegrass capital of the world, Syracuse, New York. And if we were in front of like an older crowd, you could hear the murmuring and the whispering.
Oh, no.
What?
Did you just hear that? That boy's from Syracuse.
Like, made you a marked man.
I'm going to catch a beating after this.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, I think I got some of that, too, when he would introduce me as being from the deep South Chicago.
Oh.
Yeah, there you go.
Were you ever...
Being from the South, the East Side is nothing to be ashamed of.
Were you ever tempted to, like, make up where these guys were from?
No, we just, I think, came up with different reasons why it was absurd.
You set them up. You're setting them up, that's for sure.
Well, I hate to bring everything back to food, but it's so interesting because I was interviewing, I did this book about Chicago invented foods, and I was told that the reason why we have so many interesting pizza styles is because we could experiment. We weren't bound to tradition of these Neapolitan immigrants who were just like, here's how you got to do it, and you can't change it. We said, no, we're going to try deep dish. No, we're going to try this tavern. And we were free to create other styles without being so doctrinaire. And it sounds like it was very similar with the music.
Yeah, I've never been compared to a pizza before.
Well, now that's the first time.
Well, I think we have, yeah. So we're going to basically let you guys do what you do best and play music. And I also want to thank you guys for doing this too. It's really special for me and everyone else. So thank you.
Mark, thank you for acknowledging us in your book.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Yeah. Mm.
Stick around.
Yes. To Monica for the conversation. Mark's going to be signing books out in the auditorium lobby, and books are for sale out there in just a few minutes. Thanks.
All right.
Great.
Thank you.
You.
All right. So how do we play this?
Thanks. We're only going to do 50 or 60 songs, so just... And so it seemed fitting to play the first song that was, I think it's the first song on our first record. That was a record, you know, vinyl, and it had two sides. That was the hardest part for me when CDs came out, was I couldn't get used to the fact that you didn't have to turn it over to get the other half, you know. And I'd be, oh, what, that's going to go on side two. Oh, wait a minute. Anyway, an old traditional bluegrass number. There ain't nobody going to miss me when I'm gone.
Stole my darling from me. Now there ain't nobody gonna miss me when I'm. Don't you write these words upon my headstone. There ain't nobody gonna miss me when I'm gone. Won't you write these words upon my headstone? There ain't nobody gonna miss me when I'm gone. Words upon my headstone. There ain't nobody gonna miss me when I'm gone.
Mark talked about was about this sort of cross-pollination, different people from different musical styles talking to one another. And one of the things that you can't avoid in the city of Chicago is the blues, and it's one of the most beautiful things in the world to have this African-American influence in the music, and it affects everything in the city. And this is one of the tunes we picked. It's a tune that Muddy Waters did. Actually, let me correct that. It was Howlin' Wolf that did this tune. This is called Sitting on Top of the World, done bluegrass style. Thank you.
Well, thanks very much. There's another great friend who was a big part of the world of bluegrass music here and around the country, and he is also in the book and mentioned in the book, and a phenomenal bluegrass musician who plays all the instruments and sings all the parts, and he's here today. He's right here, Roger Bello. How about it?
Thank you very much. I left Chicago in 1985, but this book, until 1985, kind of tells my life story, and every page is something I can relate to. In 1959, I started taking lessons at the Old Town School of Folk Music, and in 1966, we moved to the Uptown neighborhood, and there I met a country band and played at the Southern Center with Jimmy Rippey and the Sunny Southerners. And I started going to the University of Chicago Folk Festival, first saw Jim and Jesse there in 1966, and then I had a wonderful girlfriend, Carol Eicher, who was the head of the Folklore Society, and I helped book some of the acts of Del McCurry that came to the Folk Festival. So everything in the pages of that book, it's just my life story, and it's a wonderful work, and it's just more than nostalgic, it's something that really needs to be told. And to my buddy Dave Samuelson, he's the one who says, hey, this book came out, and you're in it. And it's an honor indeed. So thank you very much.
So when are you moving back?
I just want to put a footnote on that. Speaking of the camaraderie and the community of bluegrass music, when I saw Roger today, I said, yeah, I haven't seen you in probably 35 years, and actually the last time we were connected, I didn't see you because you moved to South Carolina and we were on tour, and you weren't there, but we stayed at your house, and it was great. He opened the door, he left the key under the mat, you know, literally, and we stayed at his house. I never saw him, so. But that's the sense of the wonderful community here.
Kentucky Waltz.
All right.
About medium tempo, not too fast, not too slow.
Gonna send it.
Oh.
There you go. He's got it.
Beautiful harvest moon, and I was a boy who was lucky. Oh, but it all ended too soon. Now I sit here alone in the moonlight. I can see your smiling face. Beautiful harvest moon. was lucky, but it all ended too soon. Now I sit here alone in the moonlight. I can see your smiling face.
How about Roger Bello? Hey. Thanks, Roger. So we're going to play a tune that I made up back in the day when we did go to Texas a lot, several times a year, and we'd stay for weeks because there was a place called the Filling Station that was the, if you saw Bonnie and Clyde, and they were always knocking off the Getty gas station, right? And that was for real, and that station was standing there idle, and somebody came along and decided to make it into a theme, a garage theme, and they call it the Filling Station. So the drinks you would order were tune-ups and overhauls, and it had different combinations of alcohol. But they made it a family place, and you could bring the kids, and so you could play 2 weeks in Austin, 2 weeks in Houston, 2 weeks in Galveston, 2 weeks in Dallas. And Willie Nelson bought the place, and his daughter ran it. So we'd go there often, and because you could stay in one place for a while. That was, if you're going to be on the road, it was really nice to stay in one place for more than a night. So anyway, I made this up. It was about 200 degrees on a Saturday afternoon. And we were playing that night, and I was on the back porch of my great friend Cornelia Cunningham's house and made this tune up and for some reason called it the Margarita Breakdown.
Cahill wrote that.
Well, we're going to get Mark to sing a good one here, actually one that he's sung, and we really are only doing maybe four or five more songs. Oh, and we're going to play this one in the same key. Okay.
You know, things may look a little improvised here, and it's because we haven't played some of these numbers together before.
That's right. All of us were in the band at one time or another, but the four of us were never in the band at the same time. So it's we're crossing repertoires here. I believe Don's going to sing you one, and this is a real treat for us, so we thank Mark for that as well, not only for writing a fantastic documentary book that has so much great info on every page, but for letting us come and play music together again. So, yay. Thank you, Mark. Yes. And thank you all for coming. We haven't seen everybody in a long time, so we appreciate you being here.
A Merle Haggard tune for you right here.
One, two, three.
My hat don't hang on the same nail too long. I tend to hear the same old song. I ain't been the highway long enough to get bogged down in the bluff. I've got rambling fever in my blood. I got this rambling fever long ago, when I first heard the lonesome whistle blow. Now I'm gonna die along the highway and ride away. some old highline cold. Restless rampant fever in my soul. Rambling fever, the kind that can't be measured by degrees. Rambling fever, there ain't no kind of cure for my disease. Well, there are times I like to bed down on the sofa and just let some pretty lady rub my back, and then spend the early morning drinking coffee, talking about when I'll be coming back. Hey, but I don't let no woman tie me down, and I'll never get too old to get around. Yes, I wanna die on the highway, like some old highline cold. Restless rambling fever in my soul. Rambling fever, the kind that can't be measured by degrees. Rambling fever, and there ain't no kind of cure for my disease.
All right.
Scruggs tune, probably from the mid-50s when they recorded this one. This is old favorite of mine. I used to do this. I think we used to call this the sound check song when I was in the band, because this is one song I would always do. This is Gonna Settle Down.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. back to her, then my rambling days are old. We'll build a little cottage on the hill, and we'll dream of days gone by, sweetheart, just you and I, and then we'll live so happy evermore. I want to go back to my darling, back to the one I love so well. I know she'll be my wife and settle down for life, 'cause she's the one that means the world to me.
Well, we're going to do one that Don and I recorded, and I think it was, what was it, 80, 90. 90 something. 1990-something, and it was an all-instrumental recording, and we put some swingy numbers on it and some bluegrass numbers, and I think we dedicated it to Jethro, actually. Because he had passed. So we're going to play that title song for you right now, just because we have fun doing it. It's one called Blue Skies.
Right there.
I just play out of tune, Don. So.
It was Jethro who used to say, "The mandolin player spends half of his life tuning, and the other half playing out of tune."
And Alan Mundy said, "What's worse than two banjos trying to get in tune at the same time?" The correct response is nothing. Okay.
Here's Blue Skies.
Thank you. very literally, we're only going to do a few more, okay? 4 or 5, 10 or 12. No, just a few.
What time does the library close?
Another Flat and Scruggs tune. You can't have a good bluegrass set without at least one song about prison, and I think this is what, maybe our third. So, an old tune called Some Old Day.
Got just about all the main first generation bluegrass pioneer artists in our set for you tonight, ladies and gentlemen. We've done songs by Bill Monroe,
and Flatt and Scruggs. And did we get a Jim and Jesse in there too? I think we did. And now we'd like to add another very important band from within the history of bluegrass music, and that's Reno and Smiley. That would be Don Reno, a fantastic banjo innovator, and Red Smiley, his singing partner. And we've got, speaking of the 1970s, we've got one here that most of us encountered in that time frame on a record by a great bluegrass band called The Seldom Seen. This one's called The Tie That Binds.
Thank you very much. Well, we're going to sing one, and then I think we're going to pick one. And Roger, you should come up and play the last tune with us, Roger. Okay? We'll figure out what it'll be. But we'll just sing. We'll get Mark to sing one here. What in B?
Yeah. One of the things I like about Flatt and Scruggs tunes is that they're dirty. I think this one was actually banned from radio because of its questionable subject matter, but I think you can figure it out. I think we're all adults in this room, and if you're not, you'll learn about it soon enough.
Is that a mandolin? No. Okay.
Flatt and Scruggs?
Well, they didn't sometimes either. All right.
I'm not
Well, thank you. Thanks for being here, and thank you to the library for having us, and thank you, Mark, for writing the great book, and this was just great fun for us.
Thank you to Leland, our sound person.
Yeah, Leland, thank you.
Makes us sound you. Better than we are.
And thanks to Monica for shepherding us through the interview. As you can tell, none of us are accustomed to public speaking.
Fiddle tune player, okay. Sure. You play it in D though, right?
All right, thank you. Thank you for allowing me to sit in. This is a wonderful experience. Returning home. And let's do a little bit of Arkansas Traveler, if you're okay.
Close.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Jennifer.
Thank you.
And all right. Thank you so much to the band. Thanks to Monica Eng, Mark Guarino. What fun. How lucky are we to live in Chicago and have this right here at our fingertips. Mark is signing books out in the lobby. The books are for sale in the lobby, so please join us there. The library does close at 8 o'clock, so we just ask to make your way out towards the exits. Thank you so much.